But I'll share a little bit about my journey in here, but it's not going to center on me per se. But let me see. I've got some slides to share. So thank you so much for the invitation. I appreciate it. And I will do my best to end right at 11:30. So this topic was offered to me, and I thought it would go well with the work I had been doing with this book. And I'll tell you about it in a moment. But as I was thinking about beloved community, of course, think about Dr. King and what he says about beloved community. So I just wanted to share a brief quote. Oh, I also wanted to say, you've had Alex G speak and Brenda Salton McNeil. Those are covenant folks. So I'm going to put a thumbs up for the Evangelical Covenant. So thank you for your partnership, not only with North Park, but also with the Evangelical Covenant Church. I appreciate it. I had Dr. Larson, David Larson, when I was there. He was a covenant pastor who taught me pastoral duties at TEDS. And when I got ordained in the covenant, he sent me a handwritten note and he remembered my time at TEDS. So I was exposed to the covenant even way back then. But Dr. King says this, or actually it's from Dr. King's website, the King Center's website. The core value of the quest for Dr. King's beloved community was agape love. And quote, an overflowing love, which is purely spontaneous, unmotivated, groundless and creative. The love of God operating in the human heart. He said that agape does not begin by discriminating between worthy and unworthy people. It begins by loving others for their sakes and makes no distinction between a friend and enemy. It is directed toward both. Agape is love seeking to preserve and create community. And I appreciate that. And I think there's the journey for love to understand it. There's more to it than, of course, the warm, mushy feelings that we sometimes associate with love. But so I'm pressing on to say that in our racialized society, part of racial healing is to recognize the power of marginalized people. And I know that's been true for me, and I think it's true for many others as well. So I did write this book, and I'll show you quickly the cover and the table of contents. I'm not going to go through all those 10 chapters there, so rest assured, we're not going to do that. But I do want to highlight a few things that that come through in the book. It was actually part of my own healing from racial trauma that I wrote the book. I mean, there's too many examples, and I'm not going to share Ted's examples. I told myself I won't do anything that makes Ted's look bad or anything like that. But let's just say I had some challenging times, and even though I did well, I mean, I graduated cum laude and eventually, you know, went on to do the PhD. But I struggled mostly culturally, not because of academics. But I was too naive. I'll take a lot of the responsibility there. I had no idea what white evangelicalism was like. I just was told by a pastor I needed to go to TEDS. When I told this pastor I was called to ministry, and I didn't apply anywhere else. I didn't know what it meant. I packed up and moved, you know, from New York out to out here to Illinois. But I learned some things along the way. So this is the book, and if you're able to check it out, I'd appreciate it, but I'm going to just share a little bit from there. If you remember in the movie Black Panther, there's this scene where King T'Challa is incapacitated, and they come to get help from the Jabari tribe, and as they approach M'Baku, the leader of the tribe, right away, this group, this entourage that's seeking help, right away, the first person to speak up is the CIA agent, Agent Ross. He's the only white guy in the group, and he starts talking for everybody. And if you remember that scene, M'Baku starts to pound his staff and bark. The rest of the Jabari tribe bark, and they drown out Agent Ross, that he has to stop talking. I wanted to stand up in the theater and cheer and shout in there, because I don't know how many times in my life I've had white people speak over me, speak for me, change my words to make it mean something else. And that scene was like empowering to me. So that was part of what was behind my writing the book. There were really kind of three streams. I mean, one of them is my experiences in church. And as you acknowledge that I was a church planter in New York and then in DC, and I was actually at two established churches in DC and Minneapolis, situations all tried to be cross-cultural in some way, or however we defined it, cross-cultural, multiracial, multi-ethnic. The language changed over the years, but we always wanted to bring a diversity of people together. And that's hard work. And I often realized that my white friends were thinking what that meant was get us in the same room. And so for them, it was a question of proximity. For me, it was a question of power. Who gets to make decisions? Who gets to influence the course and direction of things? So a lot of white pastors that were, I wouldn't say a lot because it wasn't a lot, but the few white pastors I knew who had some multicultural presence in their churches would say, it's like the United Nations. We got people from all over. And I thought, I'm from New York. The United Nations isn't about a white person up front telling all the other people what to do. It was supposed to be more collaborative work than that. So that was one of my issues. The other one was my work on First Peter. I have a kind of a pastoral commentary in the Story of God series on First Peter and saw the power of marginalized people in that book. And I'll mention that again briefly. And then thirdly, I would say that lots of what I see produced, even from people of color, is designed to center white people, even in our admonitions, is to try to get white people to behave and act differently or think differently. And it's been for centuries, people have tried to get white people to think and act differently. And that wasn't what I was trying to do in the book. What I thought was, you know what? I want to bring people who have been marginalized together for us to work in solidarity and for our voices to be elevated and amplified because our voices do matter. Part of my biblical rationale for this is this passage in 1 Corinthians, where Paul says, God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what's weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what's low and despised, things that are not, to reduce to nothing, things that are. God has chosen the marginal of society. And this is Paul talking to folks who understand how power worked and how status worked in Corinth. So I argue that there's power in the people who we tend to overlook. Folks that, as brother, I missed his name, was it Chris, that was praying at the beginning, it's those kind of folks we tend to overlook, people on the sidelines in our society that actually do represent God and the way of Jesus in some ways more accurately and faithfully than people of high status. But this notion of being the diaspora is a difficult one. Willie Jennings writes in his Acts commentary, diaspora means scattering and fragmentation, exile and loss. I don't want to take the time to read everything, so I'll just send you the slides. But this notion of the fragility, you'll see that last sentence. They live with fear as an ever-present partner in their lives, the fear of being turned into a them, a dangerous other, those people among us. Diaspora people, that's the way many of us who have life in this country have been made to feel, or we literally are scattered people from our homeland. A diaspora means vulnerability, alienation. But I argue that it's the diaspora Christians who are in the unique position to testify of Christ's power through their vulnerability. I have a lot of stories, but I'm not going to take the time to share all of them. But I do think of my own family. I think of my own history as African American. I mean, we're considered part of a diaspora. Sociologists use that term to describe folks who have been moved from their homeland. And, you know, and I have this last name of Edwards that I have absolutely no idea how I got. And I mean, I can imagine and surmise. And yet when I was a younger Christian, probably around the age of most of you, and Christianity Day was a paper magazine. I guess it still is now, but I used to get it, and then I stopped getting it for a while, but that's another story. But they would have these ads for you to get your family crest and find out, you know, what your family crest. I said, oh, because they know their audience are white Europeans. I mean, what am I going to do with an Edwards family crest? So there was that kind of blindness to our situation. Yet I'm arguing that it's the diaspora situation that makes us powerful representatives of the way of Christ. And Peter would argue that. So there's this diaspora status, but I also argue that there's power in solidarity. And I wanted to emphasize that because what I talk about in the book is sort of what you're doing with Mosaic is you're bringing voices different from different places together, which is that image of a mosaic. And I borrow from Philippians here with Paul talking to this community that understands how power operates. I mean, Philippi is a colony of Rome. Folks understand how the military works. They understand what allegiance to Caesar means. I mean, it's a pretty imperial kind of background to this. At least I would argue so. And I think Lynn Kohick, who wrote an essay on this and a book on empire in the New Testament that Scott McKnight and Joe Modica edited. There's a lot of echoing of imperialistic terms in here. But anyway, here he says that I want you to stand firm in the one spirit, striving together as one for the faith of the gospel. I highlighted that one because that's this image of solidarity. In fact, I think that Paul is borrowing from the military image that would have been well known to the folks in Philippi, this image of the phalanx, people standing together side by side as one individual. And I am hoping that more and more of us will not allow ourselves to be divided and conquered by the dominant culture. Ethnic groups have been played against each other by white folks. And this happens politically, and this happens even in Christian circles where some folks are seen as better minorities than others. If you read Isabel Wilkerson's book on caste, this notion of elevating some at the expense of others is the way power operates in our society. So I'm encouraging and urging a sense of solidarity among those who have been historically marginalized in our society, that we work together to challenge the forces of evil that are at work at times through the dominant culture. So I asked the question, what might it mean for marginalized people to resist the dominant culture's attempts to pit us against each other? And I've got some questions for you to wrestle with toward the end, but that's one I posed early on, just thinking about what does this look like for us to be working together and not pulling apart? But I particularly asked that question to folks who have been on the margins. Now, dominant folk have a role to play, of course. Dominant culture folks do, but like I use the example of Agent Ross. You know, Agent Ross was an ally to Wakanda, right? But there was a time for him to be quiet and listen. And I think that that's something that's really hard. I've been noticing now. I'm getting old, and I've noticed throughout my time in evangelicalism that that's really particularly hard for white Christians to do, to not take over. I mean, when I was planting a church in D.C., I had already planted a church in New York and struggled. It was about 6 years. And then when I did it again in D.C., I was reluctant at first, and then finally did. But we had a group of us come together, and somebody said to us, you know, are we going to have all these white folks that we know through variety of contacts wanted to come and be part of our church? And we actually had a meeting about this because some of my early core team folks were nervous about that. And as one guy said, look, white people always take over. And this was not something he said in the abstract. This had been an experience that many of us have had. So there was this sense that we couldn't have our thing. And here we were in this largely African-American community in D.C., and we had seen that happen in other places. In another largely African-American community, a white church planted there, and hardly any African-American members in the church. So you had this kind of almost weird kind of a situation of this church planted right in Washington, D.C., which had the nickname Chocolate City, and this white church sitting right there. Now, of course, it's been gentrified, and so it's kind of mocha now, I guess, not chocolate. But there's this sense of it being out of place. So we were asking those kinds of questions. So I do want solidarity, but I also am saying the dominant culture needs to pay attention to their space in these kinds of conversations. All right. I told myself I would be as positive as possible. So I want to get to the power of love. And so love is how I end the book. I end the book on love, but I don't go the way that a lot of people go, because often when we get to this power of love thing, we get this, oh, we should all just get along, hand-holding, kumbaya thing. And like I said, I've been in that. And I've been in the churches. I've preached many, many times at Christian camps, all kinds of places. And there's this sense that if we could just get together, hold hands, have potlucks, sing together, you know, do pulpit exchange, maybe get our choirs to sing in different places, then, you know, then we're good. And we still haven't wrestled with the notion of power and privilege. So that's not a bad thing. None of those are bad things. So I don't want to characterize them as evil. I just characterize them as insufficient. I say part of love means that we have to love ourselves. And I'm one of those people that understands that racial self-hatred is a real thing. And some folks have a hard time embracing who they are. I mean, I grew up in an era where James Brown had to sing "Say It Loud, I'm Black and I'm Proud," and we needed the anthem. We needed it. And now to say Black Lives Matter, I'm seeing 30, 40 years later, and we still have to assert that we matter in this society. And we have to teach our kids that we matter. So love, I'm saying, there's got to be some love for ourselves in this before we start talking about how much we're giving it away. We need to figure out, can we love ourselves? And what does that look like to know that God loves us with a deep abiding love? That when we say Black Lives Matter, in fact, rather than having that be scrutinized and vilified and dissected in every possible way, oh my goodness, it's a pretty innocuous phrase. How hard is it to affirm that people need to live? But anyway, we need to learn to love ourselves. We also know, as 1 Corinthians says, to recognize that love is patient. And love is also honest. It rejoices in the truth, as Paul would say. So I quote Miroslav Volf here, who says, "So the obligation of truthfulness and remembering is at its root an obligation to do justice, even in such a seemingly simple act as the naming of what one person has done to another." This is where there's a lot of stumbling, I think, in our attempts to come together as a society. We still have a hard time naming what has happened historically and what has been at issue in racial dynamics in our country. And so I mean, I'm going to push again Isabel Wilkerson's book, Cast. I didn't quote her here. A book came out fairly recently. But as I read it, she goes through this whole long section on what Germany has done to remind people deliberately of the Holocaust. I mean, there's constant memories of it, to the point that some people say, can't we just sort of let that? No, they don't want to let it go, because as much as they put it out there and remind people, it's a way of saying, and we're not going to go this way again. And yet in our society, we will raise up monuments to the losers, to the South. Oh my goodness, I lived in Washington, D.C. with Lee Highway and Jefferson Davis Highway. So we raise up monuments to the losers and don't remind ourselves of our own history. In fact, we have this kind of this myth of American exceptionalism. So we need to be able to name stuff. And if Christians, above all people, should be willing to do this, because we have this commitment to godly honesty. So related to that, I say love pursues justice. And I say this, racial justice trumps, is greater than racial reconciliation. So what I mean by that is that reconciliation is often meant, what I was saying earlier, it means getting us all in the same room or on the same screen. But justice means let's make it right. So, and I have learned over the years, even though I used to preach and say a lot about reconciliation, I have actually changed my language in the last 10 years or so, or maybe 15 by now, to talk about justice, because some things need to be named and made right, or at least be moving in that direction, so that we can find a sense of harmony.